Elijah Cummings, powerful Democrat who investigated Trump, dies at 68, a son of sharecroppers. He fought tirelessly for his hometown, Baltimore, and became a key figure in the impeachment investigation of President Trump. Washington, Representative Elijah E. Cummings, a son of sharecroppers who rose to become one of the most powerful Democrats in Congress and a central figure in the impeachment investigation of President Trump, died on Thursday at Johns Hopkins Hospital in Baltimore. He was 68. His death was confirmed by his wife, Mayra K. Mer Cummings, the Maryland State Democratic chairwoman. A spokeswoman, Trudy Perkins, said in a statement that Mr. Cummings died of complications concerning long-standing health challenges. No other details were given. Mr. Cummings, who was serving his 13th term representing Maryland, had been in poor health. In recent years, he had begun making his way around the Capitol in a motorized scooter and using a walker to steady himself. In 2017, he was in the hospital for 2 months after complications of a heart valve replacement. Convinced, he told the New York Times in May that he was living on borrowed time. With a booming voice and speaking cadence that hinted of the pulpit, his parents were preachers, Mr. Cummings was a compelling figure on Capitol Hill. For more than 2 decades, he represented a section of Baltimore with more than its share of social problems. He campaigned tirelessly for stricter gun control laws and help for those addicted to drugs. He was at times gruff, but always respected. But it was as chairman of the House Committee on Oversight and Reform, the panel charged with maintaining integrity in government, that Mr. Cummings may have left his most lasting legacy. The position gave him sweeping power to investigate Mr. Trump and his administration, and he used it. He sparred with Mr. Trump in the most public of ways. In February, he summoned the president's former lawyer, Michael D. Cohen, to testify about hush money payments to women who claimed to have had an affair with Mr. Trump. Mr. Cohen denounced Mr. Trump as a racist and a con man. And he issued subpoenas for Mr. Trump's financial records. Mr. Trump responded by suing him, prompting him to call the president's effort to block congressional inquiries far worse than Watergate. In an interview with The Times in May, Mr. Cummings was asked what message he would like to send to the president. "I want to send a message that we have one life to live, Mr. President," he replied. "This is no dress rehearsal. And that the American people simply want to live their lives without fear of their leaders. And we, as leaders, have a duty and a responsibility to keep our promise to them when we ran for office and won, and that is to make their lives better. While we're all on this earth, that's my message." Even as his health kept him away from Washington in recent months, Mr. Cummings, a close ally of Speaker Nancy Pelosi, remained involved in the impeachment inquiry into Mr. Trump. Those close to him said that he joined strategy calls with Ms. Pelosi and other chairmen, and signed subpoenas from his hospital bed. "In the House, Elijah was our North Star," Ms. Pelosi said in a statement. "He was a leader of towering character and integrity, whose stirring voice and steadfast values pushed the Congress and country to rise always to a higher purpose. Mr. Trump, in turn, hurled insults at Mr. Cummings, calling him racist and a brutal bully who had done a very poor job representing his constituents in Baltimore, which the president declared a disgusting, rat and rodent-infested mess. Baltimore mourns veteran congressman became a symbol of hope and stability in a city that sometimes sorely lacked it. But on Thursday, Mr. Trump offered his condolences to Mr. Cummings's family and praised the congressman on Twitter. "My warmest condolences to the family and many friends of Congressman Elijah Cummings," he wrote. "I got to see firsthand the strength, passion, and wisdom of this highly respected political leader. His work and voice on so many fronts will be very hard, if not impossible, to replace." In the Capitol, members of both parties praised him for his social conscience and dogged determination. "I can't tell you how many friends would call me and be in fear because they got a letter from Cummings, Representative Kevin McCarthy, the Republican leader," said on the House floor. But he was a man of fairness. Mr. Cummings prided himself on his slow, methodical manner, but he could also work himself into a fiery oration when his brow would furrow deeply and his voice would quiver with emotion. When Hillary Clinton, then the former Secretary of State, testified before the committee investigating the 2012 terrorist attack on Benghazi, Libya, Mr. Cummings, the panel's top Democrat, flew into a fury as she withstood hours of withering questions from Republicans. "I don't know what we want from you," Mr. Cummings cried, accusing Republicans of using taxpayer dollars to try to destroy Mrs. Clinton's presidential campaign. "Do we want to badger you over and over again until you do get so tired so we get the gotcha moment?" When Mr. Cohen testified before him in February, the most arresting moment came not from the witness, but from the congressman himself. "We have got to get back to normal," Mr. Cummings thundered from the dais in an impassioned 8-minute closing statement that quickly went viral. Elijah Eugene Cummings was born on January 18, 1951, in Baltimore, one of seven children of Robert and Ruth Cummings, and grew up in the city when it was still deeply segregated. His parents were former sharecroppers from South Carolina who had moved north to improve prospects for themselves and their children. Mr. Cummings often spoke of his mother, who with only a fourth-grade education, went from doing domestic work to eventually founding her own church, he said. Her humble past had a profound influence on him. He graduated Phi Beta Kappa from Howard University in Washington, where he was student government president, with a degree in political science. He earned a law degree from the University of Maryland and was a practicing lawyer while serving for 14 years in the Maryland House of Delegates, where he was the first African American in the state's history to be named Speaker pro tem. He was eyeing a seat in the Maryland Senate, where Democrats were in the minority, when Kwesi Mfume resigned to become president of the NAACP and he ran in a special election in 1996 to finish his term. He beat more than two dozen other Democrats in a crowded primary, which in heavily Democratic Baltimore is tantamount to winning the general election, and never had a serious challenge after that. In Washington, Mr. Cummings became active in the Congressional Black Caucus and served a term as chairman, during which time he mentored other members, like Representative Lacey Clay, who said Mr. Cummings taught him life lessons on the ways of Congress when he was a freshman. Gun control was a political as well as a personal issue for Mr. Cummings. In June 2011, his nephew Christopher Cummings was shot to death in Virginia, where he was a college student. In 2015, as Baltimore and his own West Baltimore neighborhood erupted into riots after the funeral of Freddie Gray, a young black man who had died in police custody, Mr. Cummings took to the streets, bullhorn in hand, to plead for calm. Hours earlier, ever the preacher's son, he had delivered Mr. Gray's eulogy. "Did you see him?" Mr. Cummings roared, his voice rising in anger as he implored the congregation to confront the invisibility of young black men. "Did you see him? Did you see him?" The congregation roared back with applause. Mr. Cummings rose through the ranks of the Oversight Committee to become its top Democrat. In 2019, after Democrats took control of the House, he ascended to the chairmanship, a role that gave him wide latitude. He used his authority broadly, investigating everything from whether Wilbur Ross, the Commerce Secretary, was truthful in explaining why he had added a citizenship question to the 2020 census to policy matters, like military suicides and the high cost of prescription drugs. Ms. Pelosi has appointed Representative Carolyn Maloney of New York as the acting chairwoman. The relationship between Mr. Trump and Mr. Cummings got off to a rocky start. In an April 2017 interview with the New York Times, Mr. Trump recounted their first meeting. "Elijah Cummings was in my office and he said, 'You will go down as one of the great presidents in the history of our country.'" The congressman promptly issued a statement saying he had been misquoted. "During my meeting with the president and on several occasions since then, I have said repeatedly that he could be a great president if, he takes steps to truly represent all Americans rather than continuing on the divisive and harmful path he is currently on," the statement said. That year, Mr. Cummings became ill, prompting his wife to abandon a bid for governor. "He worked until his last breath," she said in a statement on Thursday, "because he believed our democracy was the highest and best expression of our collective humanity and that our nation's diversity was our promise, not our problem." In addition to his wife, Mr. Cummings' survivors include two daughters, Jennifer and Adia Cummings, and six siblings, Robert Cummings, Jr., Jeretheria Blount, James Cummings, Diane Woodson, Carnell Cummings and Yvonne Cummings Jennings. Mr. Cummings was spiritual in his approach to his illness and his life. In the interview in May, he told the story of how one day, when he was in such dire pain that he thought he might faint, a hospital worker turned up at his bedside, saying the Lord had sent her to deliver a message, "I'm just trying to get your attention. I'm not done with you." In his final months in the Capitol, Mr. Cummings often sat in his wheelchair by the fireplace in the Speaker's lobby, the ornate chamber off the House floor, where he would read quietly or field questions from reporters. On Thursday, there was a fire going there. But Mr. Cummings's spot was empty.